You know, it's probably not a good day to Die Hard when this action movie junkie prefers a teen romance to a big budget explosion fest. But, oh well. Yippee-ki-yay. This is movie night. Hello and welcome to Movie Night, YouTube's most viewed movie review show. I'm your host, Jonathan Paula. Tonight we'll be taking a look at two of the most underrated films of 2012, a category I had the opportunity to present at this year's You Reviewer Awards, as well as the newest entry in the Die Hard series. But we begin tonight with End of Watch. This David Ayer's thriller drama was released in September of 2012, and eventually grossed over $50 million against its small $7 million budget. Jake Gyllenhaal and Michael Peña star as LAPD cops in what is easily the best police movie in years. Opening with a gripping first-person chase sequence, the basic and familiar plot follows these two best friends and partners as they patrol one of the most dangerous precincts in all of Los Angeles, slowly uncovering a massive human trafficking ring in the process. Inherently, though, all of the exciting shootouts, arrests, and car chases, which are all arrestingly filmed, are but a mere backdrop to the real story of friendship and defending your partner. It's here where the film excels. Jake and Michael have a tremendous on-screen rapport, and the highs and lows of their male bonding are incredibly believable.
That's some nice hardware. Yeah, I heard he took a shot at you. You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Good?
He's good.
Liberace's AK.
It looks like Liberace's AK. Yeah. Keep up the good work, guys. I really appreciate it. Carry on.
Thank you.
Hey, good evening, sir.
Good night, Van Houser.
Good evening, sir.
Why do you get nervous?
Women want him, men want to be him, man. He's just...
Yeah, I know, but you want him.
Dude, I'm not gay, but I'd go down on him if he asked.
Sometimes I don't know when you're kidding. And I have to know when you're kidding.
I'm not kidding.
I gotta know when you're kidding.
I'm not kidding.
At first, their uncompromising cop mentality makes for some barely redeemable characters who bend the law and beat up on criminals. Luckily, the expert writing and dialogue easily humanize them to a point where you're comfortable rooting for them to succeed. Preparing for their demanding roles, the two dedicated actors rode along with the real LAPD for 5 months prior to filming, even witnessing a real murder their first day on the job. In a smaller supporting role, Anna Kendrick is as adorable as always, commendably portraying the love interest despite having only a few lines of dialogue. With potential danger around every turn, this 109-minute film is dripping with strong tension and intense nail-biting thrills. Dropping the F-bomb an astonishing 326 times, sixth all-time for a movie, this R-rated caper is decidedly for adults only. The themes, violence, and dialogue are treated with unabashed realism. Inexplicably, the well-paced motion picture is quasi-filmed with a mixture of in-world cameras, ones the characters are actually holding and bringing around with them, security cameras mounted dash cams, and seemingly, some pretty conventional angles too. This presentation style is entirely unnecessary and only serves to diminish the effectiveness of a powerful story, reducing the movie to a sort of found footage documentary. Sporadic use of in-world music sets the mood perfectly in a number of key emotional scenes, and all of the actors easily hit their marks. The inevitable ending is truly heartbreaking, although a bit heavy-handed, with all of the proceedings capped off by a bittersweet epilogue that will surely elicit a strong response from anyone watching. Effectively bouncing from lighthearted bromance jokes to horrifying life-threatening situations with gory violence, Ayers paints a realistic and entertaining portrayal of LA street cops. End of Watch. Enjoyable, bittersweet realism. Distracting presentation. Now let's see what you had to say about this picture in the YouTube comments. End of Watch, a 9 and an 8. You applauded the gripping realism and performances in this overlooked police drama, scoring it an awesome. I was impressed and surprised by this film for the same reasons, but I was also annoyed with the in-world camera presentation. I thought it was great. Our second review tonight will be for The Perks of Being a Wallflower. This coming-of-age teen drama adapted from Stephen Chbosky's novel of the same name doubled its $13 million budget when it was released in September of 2012. The strength and power of this film adaptation can largely be attributed to Chbosky himself, who wrote his own screenplay and directed the feature, his first mainstream movie. Opening with strong and revealing first-person narration, this tightly crafted high school story takes place in the early 1990s and stars Logan Lerman as a high school freshman who becomes friends with seniors Emma Watson and Ezra Miller. After his MTV-nominated breakthrough performance in Percy Jackson 2 years earlier, 21-year-old Lerman is finally able to stretch his talents and turns in an absolutely magical and realistic performance as the angsty teen nerd who wishes to be more than an observer on the sidelines, remarking on finally being spoken to, I didn't think anyone noticed me. Following a decade of almost exclusive performances in the Harry Potter series, Watson has grown up into a beautiful and engaging talent. The two play off each other wonderfully, and it's for this most basic reason the tired story of high school politics and teen romance succeeds here so effortlessly. In a large supporting role, Miller is impressive and amusing as the goofball wingman, rounding out the trio of young actors with another solid performance. The absolutely killer soundtrack features a number of classic 80s and 90s hits, used perfectly in every instance, including an amazing and memorable moment when David Bowie's Heroes is blasting on the radio as the group drives through a tunnel late at night.
What is she doing?
Don't worry, she does it all the time.
Turn it up!
Got it, Your Highness.
All we can be heroes, just for one day.
I feel infinite.
It's these lasting and beautifully shot moments that stitch together a compelling and enjoyable cinematic experience for all 102 minutes of the film. Perhaps the most iconic and powerful scene is when Lerman repeats sage advice his teacher Paul Rudd told him, when he shares his feelings to Watson, confessing, "We accept the love we think we deserve." Although the strength of these scenes depends on your own adolescent experiences, they are nothing short of goosebump-inducing. A cluttered plot thread about mental illness is introduced late, and some other background characters receive little beyond the most cursory and formulaic developments, but by and large, this carefully paced PG-13 drama is overwhelmingly enjoyable and moving. Almost criminally overlooked when it was released last year, this film's oft-repeated perspective on infinity is perhaps a hint of this film's staying power, an eventual cult hit that everyone ought to discover for themselves. The Perks of Being a Wallflower, transcendently poignant, lasting, and relatable. Let's read some of your reviews now that you've heard from me. Our scores for The Perks of Being a Wallflower, a rare double 10. Unanimous praise was given to the performances, story, and execution. You thought this film was amazing. Passionately directed with a hopeful and honest tone, but still flawed, I initially hesitated to give this picture my highest rating, but honestly, there were a few pictures from 2012 that I enjoyed more. I thought this movie was amazing as well. Before our final review, let's have a word from our sponsor. For just $30 a month, you can see one new movie in theaters every day by using MoviePass. Just this last week, my wife, Riley, and I saved $11 per ticket by using the great service. So please check out moviepass.com/jogwheel and take advantage of my exclusive invites, which will also get you $10 off. Finally tonight, let's review A Good Day to Die Hard. Released nationwide on Valentine's Day 2013, the fifth entry in this long-running and now tired series, director John Moore sincerely attempts to maintain the feel of the earlier pictures. The 1988 original remains one of my all-time favorite movies, and in my season 1 review, I famously mentioned that you're a failure at life if you haven't seen it yet. A link to that review, as well as my quick 5-word summaries for the entire franchise, are included below if you're curious how I'd rank the other movies. But as for the newest sequel, a complete failure on almost all counts, especially considering some of my favorite lines from the trailer are noticeably missing. An aging Bruce Willis is back as sarcastic New York cop turned invincible superhero action star John McClane, who travels to Moscow to reunite with his estranged son, Jai Courtney, an ass-kicking CIA spy. At 57, Willis is still as amusing and capable as ever, but in this picture he's mostly reduced to playing second fiddle, with all of his best moments coming from his comedic quips rather than his fists and bullets. Following the natural progression of threats in the earlier films that went from building to airport to city to country, the stakes here are global, as the Russian bad guys are apparently after some weapons-grade uranium. The return of the R rating was a welcome sight after the watered-down Live Free or Die Hard, but it is entirely wasted here. The handful of F-bombs we do get, including McClane's signature catchphrase, do very little to redeem this failure. With his best picture to date being 2001's underwhelming Behind Enemy Lines, director Moore is over his head here, producing the worst thing to happen to Russia since Police Academy 7. Unable to tell even the most basic of comprehensive stories, the confusing plot relies on big-budget CGI explosions, needlessly shaky cameras, and fake stunt work to hide its many faults. An early chase scene through the streets of Moscow was devoid of any tension or excitement, as the sloppy editing makes it impossible to truly tell what's going on. The overly long sequence descends into a messy parade of pointless collisions and unwarranted destruction of property.
Do you think I understand a word you're saying?
Jesus Christ.
It's okay. I'm fine, thanks.
97 minutes, this is the shortest Die Hard by over a half hour. But the pacing is so downright awful and inconsistent, it actually feels like the longest. Stretches of uninspired and boring dialogue slow this adventure to a crawl, killing any excitement. Prior to the explosive final act, the father-son duo literally question out loud why they don't just leave early and call it a day. It is honestly embarrassing that the only thing driving this empty plot is McClane remarking that they have nothing better to do. There's no strong villain here, no ticking clock, few memorable action scenes, and nothing remotely close to well-written dialogue. Ignoring real-world geography, the climax takes place in a burned-out Chernobyl's weapon vault, with Willis and Courtney traveling the 12-hour distance in a single scene transition. While it'll no doubt earn back its budget, this picture is a missed opportunity. There are quick moments, jokes, and short action scenes that actually work pretty well, like when Willis lays siege on an invading terrorist group at a compromised safe house. But when it's so uninteresting and poorly executed, it's impossible for even the biggest Die Hard fans to truly enjoy this picture. A good day to Die Hard. Fleeting enjoyment and utter disappointment. Now let's see what you had to say about this film in the YouTube comments. A good day to Die Hard on the Rate-O-Matic, a 5 and a 4. You were unhappy with this picture, with everyone agreeing it's the worst Die Hard yet, but you still enjoyed it enough to give it an alright. I really wanted to like this picture, but between the shoddy pacing, confusing story, bland action, terrible dialogue, short runtime, and jumbled editing, it is honestly amazing I was able to pull enough from this wreck of a picture to momentarily enjoy it enough to score it a meh. Now let's read some of your tweet critiques to see what else is currently playing in theaters. If you see a new movie in theaters, tweet your review using the JPMN hashtag to have it featured on the show. Next week will be our third annual Movie Night Oscar special, and we'll be reviewing all 9 of this year's Best Picture nominees. Armor, Argo, Beasts of the Southern Wild, Django Unchained, Les Miserables, Life of Pi, Lincoln, Silver Linings Playbook, and Zero Dark Thirty. I'm going to need many reviews for each, so please let me know what you think about these movies by voting in the polls below or by leaving some comment reviews. And remember to check out the Movie Night Archive for an organized library of all our past reviews. Once again, my name is Jonathan Paula. Thank you for watching Movie Night. I hope to see you right back here next Friday.